Thank you for joining us for this edition for Live at the Q. My good friend and Senator David Haley is our guest today. He did mention something I think is worth mentioning. The title of our show is Live at the Q, and not necessarily from proximity, but more in terms of mentality. So that being said, we're going to talk about a number of different issues with the Senator, who have been a friend of mine for approaching 30 years, and we have a long history of doing things in the community. Senator, would you please give us a little background about your years of service and the different offices in which you've operated in our community?
First, thank you, Joe, for having me live at the Q. I appreciate what you're doing and putting this out in a media, in a forum where we can talk about issues that benefit Kansas City, Kansas, Wyandotte County. Yes. I'm a native Wyandotte Countyan, born right here, right off Quindaro. I'm born over at the old Douglas Hospital, which is in the heart of what is now called the Quindaro Ruin. So I appreciate
this opportunity to discuss in particular
what it means, because I was at the Q at birth.
And off to a running start. And I like the leisurely format that I can have with my friends. As I mentioned, this is not just a person who holds public office, but this is someone I have a personal relationship with, and we talk to from time to time, from anything from travel to any number of different subjects. I do want to ask you right into the meat of the matter, brother. How, in your opinion, can Quindaro specifically, this is my imagined Quindaro, and we've talked about this, how can Quindaro be an artery, an economic artery, to the Northeast at large? Not specifically, I know, and I realize that you serve at large, the community in Kansas, and the district in which you represent, but how can Quindaro specifically, like Vegas has a strip, like what's been done from an entertainment perspective with Vine and our sister city of Missouri, how can that be realized and actualized in Kansas, in your opinion?
Well, I mean, that's a complex question, you know, because the reason why it's so complex in and of itself is there are many different avenues we could take. There certainly should be private-public partnership in enhancing not only Quindaro, but any artery or any part of a city or a county. You mentioned 18th and Vine in Kansas City, Missouri, and we've watched most recently how there's been a need for constant public or governmental infusion.
Yes.
That it doesn't make it on its own. It would not survive, that being 18th and Vine, despite the many attractions there. That they have with the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum and the American Jazz Museum.
Yes.
And various venues, entertainment venues like Danny's Big Easy, the Blue Room, the Juke House, and yes, others, the Mutual Musician Foundation, that they still need to have the city to post up with significant revenue, because the driver of consumerism, of tourism, in and of itself doesn't sustain it. So to get to your question, what model might best work here at the Q?
Yes.
To enhance, certainly in my view, one such venue would be the Quindaro Ruins. The Quindaro Ruins has, I think, a great attraction to many people around the country.
Nationally. Yes.
Nationally. We have the Underground Railroad. We have the concept of integration in a community that was pre-Civil War with the township of Quindaro here in Wyandotte County. And there's already a great interest. People go to the Quindaro Ruins right now with no formal guide to walk them through, and it's sometimes dangerous to go down the trails based on weather conditions and
coyotes.
Well, not coyotes. Heard of a couple snakes. and we can enhance that. If I were in a position to work with our commission, if the mayor and the commission could best understand that beyond, as we have worked in partnership to create out of whole cloth, out of farmland,
the
legend with the Speedway, we can do that with a fraction to spur and to maintain the existing interest in the Quindaro Township. That would be a feeder for the Boulevard if, in fact, we had, in my mind, this is just my opinion, you asked for it, that's what we can do, is to enhance what we already have and then build on the storefronts that are vacant, the residential aspects as we see multiculturalism take these older houses and renovate them.
Is this the case? Yes. It's currently occurring. Yes.
That's what's happening.
That's what's happening.
And if we don't fill up the houses and the stores, some of them beautiful architecture, beyond their historic attributes, Joe, then they'll tear them down. We'll demolish them. And at the Q at 18th and Quindaro, beautiful structure, historic structure called the Quindaro State Bank.
Yes, it is.
For a fraction, the government, the public investment and private investment could be phenomenal as a catalyst for that part of Quindaro, for the enhancement. You and I worked together almost 30 years ago for the BUY, B-U-Y, on Quindaro,
yes.
Working with Alonzo Washington and the BNC. Remember the BNC? What happened to the beret, brother?
I dusted off.
Yeah. It's time.
Yes, sir. Yes,
but
sir.
You and I encouraged,
yes,
through the BNC, working with Alonzo and others and the other group,
yes,
to have people buy on Quindaro between June 19th and July 4th. Because freedom isn't always free. We handed out flyers. And we're here now so many years later. It's still the issue of how do we get the public more involved in our economic and social stability and enhancement.
I've got two A and B portion of a question. You bring up something I think is particularly relevant, because I think thematically, you know, if you talk about the historical element that is Quindaro ruins, or already you said there's interest that people pursue on their own volition now, without much of encouragement in terms of a systemic or infrastructure way in which they could enjoy the ruins. It'd be nice to see such a thing come to reality. I think that thematically, historically or tourist-based, I think that if we do it in a historical perspective, it could have the same capacity that Union Station did with its revitalization in terms of serving all of, if you will, the school districts on both sides of the water as being a destination. So people have school districts offer to their children to go to Union Station, Science City, these things, as a result of a field trip. That's ideally what's suitable for the ruins. That's a part of our history. That's part of our history as Kansas Cityans, both from where Park University happens to be now, from that side of the story, to getting to what was the Quindaro Township, which was the riverfront town, as you mentioned. It's so rich there, more so in what this one particular time will allow us to do so. Allow me this detour, brother.
It's your show.
You mentioned, and I use the word gingerly, gentrification of our own community, of the multiculturalism that's happening right now in the Northeast. I want to ask, and this is particularly sensitive, and it's not a segue to talk about what your particular history is, because you ought to be sensitive to this, given that you know it all very intimately. What happens when you lose identity? You being the Haley, when you have identified geographically, language, culturally, for generations and decades as one thing, and now with the influx of other language, culture, coming on the onset, is there such a thing as there, I don't sense by any means, brother, that there's a conflict. And I do believe there can be coexistence. But definitively, what does that Quindaro of the 21st century look like? That's my question. If the Quindaro that you, as you mentioned, was born on, is not what the 21st century Quindaro is, what is that Quindaro from an identity perspective today? Is it what we've known it to be as being the Northeast, being largely residents black? Now, as you mentioned, there's Asian, there's Hispanic, there's white, there's all the above that's taking place, which I'm happy and glad to see. But what does that Quindaro become that can be both, inclusive, as well as definitive in, with respect to what it was and what it can be, in your opinion? Or is there such a thing? Is the new Quindaro that has all the multi-ethnic residents the Quindaro that we've known of old?
Okay. And that's a very good question, and in my opinion, the new Quindaro is what the old Quindaro symbolizes. The beauty of the Quindaro Township, and there's a plaque out there, actually, if you go way up 20, just talking about the ruins, what Quindaro means is, the Indian word means a bundle of sticks. Mm-hmm. And so united, if you put different sticks together, they're that stronger. If you put this culture, this culture, this culture, if you put those sticks together, Quindaro, in the tribal word, the Indian word, the Native American word, then Quindaro is that bundle of sticks, and in that unity, they're stronger together. If you'll pardon the pun. Well, actually, it's a slogan for someone running for president right now. Stronger together is that bundle of sticks. You know, I'm David Haley, and I approve. But we have these bundles of sticks here. We have black, brown, white, red, yellow.
Yes.
Bundled together.
Which is what it was originally. Thank you for bringing me full circle. Because originally the Quindaro Riverfront Town was a place where, both economically as well as residentially, where all those people were participants of. If you know history, if you know Quindaro's history, Quindaro was an Indian woman. Her husband happened to be a white man.
Exactly.
And that was a white community that was very embracive to black merchants as well as consumers of that era. So, in essence, we're not doing anything new. I hear you. Thank you.
Thank you for bringing me full circle. From one place to come to another land, or maybe the land was right across from Missouri.
Missouri.
They were coming to, as we also have other immigrants who are coming from other places looking for a better life.
Exactly.
As black came, as brown came, as red, who are already here, maintained, along with white settlers. That's what Quindaro is. That's who that bundle of sticks historically has been.
And, brother,
and that's what it was, and that's what it can be again, and we can take greater pride. I say that from my history, or from the history that was shown in Roots, and for just one of literally tens of thousands of families of different races who've come to this country, who've come to this land in search of a better life, and who have not only prospered, but have been part of the infrastructure now, the social infrastructure, the tapestry of this country.
And on that note, we'll be right back.
Everybody was soul food catering.
I always done 12th in Brooklyn. Gates, of course, is the hub. But there's Peachtree. There's apparel stores. There's a hardware store. There's any number of different merchants right there on that four block. And on some occasions, I've been there at the light, and he's got some music playing right there at the light. So what he's been able to do just at 12th and Brooklyn, I would like to, wouldn't it be nice to say we could do that 18th Quindaro? So that being said, it's kind of, there are some examples of it that's here locally that, you know, we can cite and experience and recognize. Go to the currently, or this is not something that's on the table. This is something that, you know, we can just realize now. I'd like to see that come to fruition. And I do believe this, brother, that the army is not necessarily the masses. I believe that when you get people who are progressive and committed, you can get something done with one man and an armor bearer. So, in part, that's why I have you here. We've been working together with history of having worked together. And I'd like to see, from a legacy standpoint, not for ego, not for none of that, but something that's utilitarian for the community, whether it's listening to music at a stoplight, or whether it's going into a merchant. And back in our day, I don't know if you remember this, going to get you some Nihilators, a Hot Pickle, some Zoom Zooms, and some Wham Whams at Taylor's, and it. Kitties and fried pie, that era. But we live in a cyber world now, brother. And largely, to this generation, they have a cyber existence as opposed to a brick and mortar existence. So maybe we'll get to the day where the drone will deliver your fried pie to your door of your home. But I think that there can be a culmination of the two cohabitating. I believe in the spiritual realm, you have supernatural and you have natural. And they're not in opposition with each other. They're like the street that we're near. Parallel. They parallel one another. So what you said earlier, from the economic arm side, as well as the social progressive side, the political side, from the community, how do we lay the tracks that our streetcar to our new reality takes us to, in your opinion?
Well, I mean, of course you encapsulate a couple of concepts there. You diverted me because now I'm thinking about Hot Pickles. I hadn't had a Hot Pickle in a long time. But so you threw me off a little bit. You know, I was doing all right.
Pleasant memory?
Very pleasant. We don't have them
them anymore.
Right, exactly. We can't even go up here to the snack bag. They have them up there. Snack.
I don't think so.
Okay, well, anyway, we'll just, you know,
at,
we'll
any rate.
Get at some point. The point, I think, the larger point he's trying to make, and I think, and I've always said this, that you know, politics, I'm in government. I've been very fortunate, very blessed to be a part now for 22 years in elected office in Topeka, which is sometimes difficult because there's not always flowing from our state capitals to our cities. It's normally a federal to a city flow. That's usually the way that, I mean, really. And I've wanted sometimes to see the city get more involved. And politics, though, has to better understand the politics of business. And on the converse, business has to better understand the business of politics.
Well said.
And if you think about that, if that marinates for a moment, if we have a business community that appreciates the arms of political infrastructure, because so often people who are in business don't fully understand what the political implications are of at the city, the state, or the federal level. Businesses need to better understand that, whether it's Kitties. I remember Pee Wee used to have the pie.
That's right.
Mommy had the pie. Whether it's them, and to how that affects not only their bottom line, but growing their business.
Okay.
What you were talking about with Gates over the Gates, a businessman.
Yes, sir.
Understood and worked very closely with the business of politics, the various different areas he had to. And conversely, then politics understood better the politics of his business, his needs, not just from barbecue, but also from being a development entity.
True.
Where do we have that here in Kansas City, Kansas? Where do we have this in the state of Kansas?
We'll see.
Where do we have this? Where is that flow? How is that enhanced? And what do we do? What do we do to enhance that? If it's on Quindaro, which is a great place for it, to have that happen, because we've got so much to build on.
Yes.
How and when do we find that fulcrum to have those two entities interrelate?
Is Ollie the template of the intermediary of what that looks like?
I don't know. Is it a one-size-fits-all? There are different dynamics that are here, and we can better capitalize, I think, on what makes us unique. Wyandotte County is the most diverse county
in the state of
Kansas.
Yes, sir.
105 counties in Kansas, Wyandotte County, especially the 4th Senate District, which I'm privileged to represent, which is about half the county. There's such a mix of everything, more so than any of the other 39 districts in the state. So how do we capitalize on that, which makes us diverse? Where do we find the strengths, and how do we marry those strengths? The strength of the diversity, the strengths of different talents, and how do we bring those together to enhance our collective future together? That's a key question. I'm not sure that I have the immediate answer.
Yes.
But I certainly think it's an opportunity. It's a real opportunity for us to be at the forefront. Now, we did build out here the Speedway. We built the Speedway, again, out of whole cloth, out of farmland. Yes. There was an investment made that made Wyandotte County now the number one destination, tourist destination, and entertainment destination in the state of Kansas.
Yes.
And we have highs and lows. We've got the legends. We have Schlitterbahn. We have a place where people come. But it was built at a tremendous investment. And we forewent the tax revenue, we Wyandotte Countyans did, to say that down the road we would benefit. Here now, the benefits coming back, we're getting $12 to $13 million additionally starting this year into the city budget.
Coffers,
Having gone for so many, over a decade, without the revenue, it's coming in. Here's the key question for our local, our state, and even our federal leadership to contemplate. If I were in the position to do it, I would say, Joe, we should take that revenue and to plant seeds, government-inspired revenue, plant seeds with businesses, with the, if you want to use Gates as an example, or with the Stricklands, with different entities that are somewhat established but need to have that seed watered and nurtured.
Right.
From a business from a standpoint of having that enhanced to show we care all around the county, not just in one area. That's what I think. I certainly, if my leadership meant anything, that's what I would do. While we have that revenue, because we're not going to have the Speedway forever.
Right.
How long are people going to keep watching NASCAR go round and round and round? Hopefully for another decade, maybe another 20 years. I hope so, because we have a tremendous investment out there.
Yes.
But in the event that it begins to wane and revenues are down and we're no longer getting that money back, we can at least inspire and nurture entities all around Wyandotte County so that we can grow ourselves unilaterally. A high tide from out west should lift all the boats, as far as I'm concerned, throughout Wyandotte County.
We'll be right back.
My hood rap's kinda sorta easy to find, so I practice making orders. Money on our brain while I bumpin' Travis Porter. Allergic to temp change, so I don't do quarters. Relaxing, haters be axing. Water mice on your jacket, I'm hood ratting. Stacking cheese, hood rats in action. Pass the ball, it's a chain reaction. Probably Gucci or Nietzsche and hood rats a pearl. I'm stuck in the sky, so I'm sitting on top of the world. Just think about diamonds and pearls, cause I'm sitting on top of the world.
Jerome, put on that Bobby Womack.
Nah, girl, I wanna go way back. Oh yeah, check this out.
Back in the days when I was young, I'm not a kid anymore. But some days I sit and wish I was a kid again. Back in the days when I was young, I'm not a kid anymore. But some days I sit and wish I was a kid again. Back in the days when I was young, I'm not a kid anymore. But some days I sit and wish I was a kid again.
I don't live down there by choice.
Yes.
I live where I was blessed to be born.
Yes.
And the people who allowed me to serve in this upright community.
Yes.
And it's been very good to me. And
it's
good to all of us.
Yes.
And when you go to other parts of the world and you see how people are able to be appreciative of their environments and their surroundings and how to have full, happy lives, and you realize how much more we have. That's the greatest benefit for me of Central America, of West Africa. But when I come back home, I'm grateful to be here, blessed to be here.
But I like what you said in terms of full life. And full life is not defined by having. You know, what's the profit of man to gain the whole world, lose his soul? You can have any number of possessions and things and still not have satisfaction. So I remember what you said one time, a conversation that we had in terms of, you were talking about square footage about your residence in Belize. You could be in a mansion and be miserable. And you could be in an outhouse having a ball.
Well, you know, I mean, I lost my father, George Haley, a year ago. And so I had his jacket on. He had a threadbare, I looked at all the clothes in the closet and the recognitions on the wall and what have you, all of that. At some point in time, everything that we have, no matter where our stature was, it's just a matter of transition.
Yes.
And where that transition goes is a matter of appreciation. You know, we grieve, and love is a part of grief. If you don't love somebody, you don't grieve something. I mean, but to maintain the continuity that we share of a beautiful, rich history from the Guindaro Ruins, Douglas Hospital.
From Africa.
And for those who come from Asia or from
otherwise.
Latin America or from, you know, wherever their roots might be, to extol and to enhance and to share and to be a part of that which we have been and to take pride in it and to build on it to share with the subsequent generation, even if they have their hands and faces down on their, you know, on their
devices.
Phones and their devices, is to try to instill and to be a link in that human chain. In the human chain for the time that we're here.
And as you set me up so eloquently, Emperor has on new clothes. But I think about Joseph and his multicolored coat and being in his father's favor. I said, I think the tangibility, when we're talking about in terms of legacy, what Condero offers, in terms of a thoroughfare of going from one place of consciousness to another as opposed to an address, and how that's beget from a baton sense from one generation to another. Definitively, the Quindaro that you and I know, as you mentioned, the hospital, is someone who was of a certain generation and has not been part of the reality. Although numerically the address may be the same for what it was to one generation to another, it may be entirely different environmentally than what it was from one generation to another. And when you mention about, we're talking about vision, particularly from a political standpoint, oftentimes politically things have a shelf life because you may have a 4-year term, an 8-year term. How does that thing that you have in terms of, because the Bible says where there's no vision, people perish. How does that happen when you have someone, mayor, senator, governor, who's a visionary, and then he's come, he's replaced by a demagogue? And how does that ultimately, I think, which is the mark of the stature and status of anything, stand the test of time? Not that there ceases to be hot pickles. It ceases to be places where we can go and get them.
Well, that's a larger question than I can answer. And it's a larger question than I think that any one particular can. But, I mean, we do look at, we're looking at what's happening nationally in presidential politics right now. In a democracy, it's about who people will get behind. Mm-hmm. And where their mindset is, or lack of mindset, as the case may be, you know, but just whatever really they respond to, the rhetoric or to the action. I mean, that's democracy.
Yes.
That's democracy. And we can snipe from either side, but that's the way
it is. What it is.
And many of the people who snipe from one side or the other don't really participate. They say, I'm not going to even participate in democracy. I'm not going to even vote, because the very best optimum that I want is not one of those considerations I have. So I'm taking my marbles and go home. And that in a democracy is how we diminish, really, the opportunity to have addressed the issues that are dearest to us indeed. Because if we don't have it all, and that's the meistic society we're in, if everything isn't met in my criteria, I'm not going to settle for second. I'm not going to settle for second, I just won't. And it's that kind of short-sightedness in a democracy that leads us with untenable choices.
Yes.
They're often in positions at the local level and maybe even at the national.
That being said, I'd like to say this. Thank our guest, Senator David Haley.
Thank you.
I have to present him with, as is our practice on this show, our sponsor, our apparel line, which is Hood Rats, still keeping it hood. So, brother, you now have hood credibility.
Oh, well, thank you.
Which you had before, because I don't have nobody on my show who ain't got it.
I was about to say
it. That right there, brother.
I worked hard.
You turned.
That's right.
That shirt right there.
That's right.
Thank you. And we look for you next time on Still Keeping It Hood, live at the Q.
Peace out.
Was that a show? Or was that a show, bro?
Take it rough. It's been the same old thing on my block. You either working or you slanging cocaine on my block. You had to hustle, cause that's how we was raised on my block. And you stayed on your hop until you made you a knot on my block. To hang out was the thing back then. And even when you left out, you came back in to my block. From Holloway, Belfort to Scott, Reed Road, the flocks, we know the spots. So we the rocks, the drink or the